It was the morning of Wednesday, 3rd of November 1920, and as night turned to day, the people of Athlone could finally see the extent of the damage done to the town's printworks. The building was a mass of ruins and twisted pillars with all the expensive printing machinery reduced to rubble. Amid the debris was the bizarre sight of the melted print type forming pools of molten metal. The business, which had employed well over 100 people, was gone. How did it come to this? Why had the printworks been attacked? And why did the Crown forces regard the Westmeath Independent as an enemy of British rule in Ireland? If we rewind 6 years to the beginning of the First World War, the readers of the Westmeath Independent would have seen their weekly paper carry headlines such as "Intolerable German aggression to be crushed," "England champions the cause of freedom supported by a united Ireland." The paper was a proud ally of the British war effort, regularly calling for Irishmen to join the British Army. Yet a number of factors caused the paper to reassess its editorial policy between 1914 and 1920. There was, among other developments, the British government's equivocations over Home Rule, the thousands of Irish casualties on the Western Front and at Gallipoli, the constraints which Dublin Castle imposed on newspapers, the Easter Rising of 1916, the conscription crisis of 1918, and the general election in December of that year, which had been dominated by Sinn Féin. Between 1914 and 1920, the Westmeath Independent and the Athlone Printworks were owned by the Chapman family, who had purchased the businesses in the 1880s. Limerick-born Michael McDermott Hayes became editor of the paper in the early 1900s, a position he would hold until 1921, having previously worked with a range of newspapers from the Limerick Leader to the Daily Express in Dublin. Despite his support for Irish recruitment to the British Army, McDermott Hayes would become increasingly critical of both the British government and the Irish Parliamentary Party after the 1916 Rising. McDermott Hayes was particularly enraged by what he considered as the Irish Parliamentary Party's failure with regard to the treatment of interned Republicans and the growing prospect of partition. By the time of the conscription crisis of 1918, when the British government tried to impose compulsory enlistment in Ireland, the Westmeath Independent took a leading role in local efforts to defeat what the paper described as a blood tax on the Irish people. This editorial policy did not go unnoticed by Dublin Castle, and in April of that year, it ordered that the paper be shut down for supposedly contravening the censorship regulations. In the early hours of 5th of April, a party of British soldiers entered the offices of the Westmeath Independent and began to dismantle the printing machinery. This work took 2 hours, enough time for a crowd to gather in the vicinity, and they indulged in hissing and booing when the soldiers departed carrying boxes of disassembled printing equipment. On the day after the suppression, which would last for 2 weeks, the Irish Independent interviewed Thomas Chapman. Chapman suggested that his paper was targeted by Dublin Castle not because it had broken any regulations, but because it, and to quote Chapman, pursued a strong political policy demanding a settlement of the Irish question on independent national lines. Chapman was referring to his and his editor's attitudes towards Sinn Féin. By this stage, the paper was widely seen not only as a critic of the Irish Parliamentary Party, but as a supporter of the Republican Party. This support extended beyond the pages of the paper, since both Chapman and McDermott Hayes had become committee members of Sinn Féin's Athlone branch in August 1917. 2 months later, an editorial in the paper declared that Sinn Féin policies were the only effective weapon to save the Irish nation. By the time of the local elections of June 1920, the paper was running banner headlines such as "Sinn Féin is the nation, vote for the nation's candidates." At the same time, the Westmeath Independent denounced British policy in Ireland, and the British Prime Minister David Lloyd George was a particular target. He was, the paper editorialised in June 1920, "the greatest trickster of his age, an overrated poltroon, whose love of office and power has made him a renegade." When it came to a settlement for Ireland, the paper went further than many of its contemporaries. Whereas others pushed for full dominion home rule for Ireland, the Westmeath Independent's editorials hinted at a desire for outright separation from the British Empire. The Westmeath Independent was thus one of the county's most obvious critics of the Crown forces and British rule in Ireland. Yet it had always remained within the boundaries of the law, a point that was made by Frederick Roberts, MP for West Bromwich and a member of the Typographical Union, when he defended the Westmeath Independent in the House of Commons during 1920. Roberts said, It may be that they have been critical of the government, and rightly so, but I do not think it can be claimed that they have in the least degree abused the freedom of the great profession with which they are associated. While the Westmeath Independent remained within the boundaries of the law, the same could not be said of the Crown Forces. The Printworks was first attacked by the Auxiliary Division of the RIC on the 16th of October 1920. They set fire to the building, causing much damage to the ground floor, although the rest of the Printworks was saved. The events of that night were described by the Westmeath Examiner as an outbreak of terrorism, and the residents of Athlone were left stunned and outraged by what had occurred. The first attack on the Printworks marked the beginning of a short but intense period of violence in the county. A week after that attack, a section of the Crown Forces carried out reprisals in Moat and in Athlone, where they shot and fatally wounded Michael Burke, a former town councillor. Despite the fevered atmosphere, the Westmeath Independent advised its readers in an editorial on the 23rd of October 1920 that it would not change course.
All we can surmise is that the attack on our works was because of the publication of some article or item of news. Our paper has always been for a peaceful settlement and has denounced and will continue to denounce the awful misrule under which the country has been driven to the verge of madness, and will aim at reflecting the opinions held by 90% of the people in the area over which it circulates. There is no bravado in this. We know the danger in which our property stands, and the material loss its destruction would mean for the owners. Our workers too were alive to the serious loss it would mean to them and to the town.
This was a courageous defence of free speech. Just over a week later, the auxiliaries returned and launched their second attack. This time, they destroyed the Printworks, silencing a newspaper they considered to be an enemy.